Einen schönen guten Abend und herzlich willkommen zu unserer Lecture-Reihe Die Revolution findet trotzdem statt, das Kino von Pier Paolo Pasolini. Und es ist eine ganz besondere Veranstaltung, denn es ist die 14. und letzte in unserem Zyklus, den wir in diesem Jahr, beziehungsweise seit Oktober letzten Jahres gemacht haben. Es ist etwas ganz Besonderes für uns hier immer im Filmmuseum, denn es ist eine interdisziplinäre Reihe. Das heißt, wir beleuchten das Thema von unterschiedlichen wissenschaftlichen Gesichtspunkten. Und ja, freuen uns da ganz besonders, dass es so toll geklappt hat mit der Kooperation mit der Goethe-Universität. Dank an die Filmwissenschaft, die Kunstgeschichte und die Romanistik nochmal an dieser Stelle. Und es ist auch ein Applaus wert, die uns die wunderbaren Referenten besorgt haben. Es ist auch deswegen etwas Besonderes, denn wir schreiben das 40. Todesjahr von Pasolini. Vor 40 Jahren ist er gewaltsam ums Leben gekommen. Und ich denke, es war an der Zeit, einmal wieder sich seinem Werk so ausführlich zu widmen, wie wir es jetzt hier getan haben. Für mich ist es ein besonderes Highlight, denn Mama Roma zähle ich jetzt zu meinen persönlichen Lieblingsfilmen und freue mich sehr, dass wir heute auch eine richtig tolle Kopie davon bekommen haben. 35 mm analog natürlich von Cinecittà mit englischen Untertiteln. Und das ist wirklich was Seltenes, was wir hier Ihnen präsentieren dürfen. Zumal auch da die rechte Situation immer etwas schwierig ist, deswegen wird der Film in Deutschland in Kinos eher selten gezeigt. Ich möchte Sie auch gerne schon mal darauf hinweisen, wie immer haben wir auch noch in unserem letzten Monat ein Begleitprogramm zu unserer Lecture-Reihe, die sich ja mit Kino und Filmen befasst, die Pasolini in irgendeiner Form beeinflusst haben oder in seinem Dunstkreis standen. Und ja, falls Sie sich mal gefragt haben, wie konnte Salò 1975 entstehen, es gab das Nunsploitation-Genre, würde ich mal sagen. Das ist eine Mischung aus Exploitation und Nonnenfilm. Und wir haben es geschafft, jetzt hier auch drei Klassiker, sofern man davon sprechen kann, zu besorgen. Das eine ist The Devils von Ken Russell, mit unter anderem Vanessa Redgrave in einer der Hauptrollen. Dann in einer restaurierten Fassung Flavia la Monaca Musulmana, ein großer Klassiker, wie mir Markus Stiegelegger, der Experte auf dem Gebiet ist, sagte, bestätigte. Und Die Nonnen von Clichy, das ist dann auch noch ein französisches Werk. Alles Anfang der 70er entstanden, das zeigen wir Ihnen in unserer Late-Night-Schiene. Also wenn Sie Lust auf mal was ganz anderes haben, dann empfehle ich Ihnen das Freitag, Samstag, 22.30 Uhr. Das soll genug des Werbeblocks sein. Ich möchte an dieser Stelle überleiten an Rembert Hüser, der das Vergnügen hat, heute unseren Referenten Cesare Casarino vorzustellen. Ich wünsche Ihnen und uns allen ganz viel Vergnügen beim letzten Teil von Pasolini.
Yeah, hello everybody, good evening. And it's a sad occasion today, so that's as it is the last day of the Pasolini series, which is which was quite eventful, and we had a lot of really quite amazing talks, and I always thought with each talk, wow, this was really impressive, and Cesare is still to come. It's my privilege, and it's a tremendous pleasure to welcome Cesare Casarino both to Frankfurt and to the Film Museum and to the series here, and also to briefly introduce him to you. So Cesare is one of the leading Marxist and political thinkers in the U.S. He's somebody who can, as the Americans say, can wear several disciplinary hats with equal success. So you can discuss with him endlessly through the night with all the students in Minneapolis wanted to write their PhD with him, all the good students. And he was famous for his legendary parties at his house. At the same time, he's a chair of the Department of Cultural Studies and Comparative Literature. He's the editor of Cultural Critique, and he has written way too many books and articles that I could mention it. So it's pretty much with all major publishing houses and famous journals, from Stanford University Press to Diacritics, October, Critical Inquiry. So this is, name me a journal and you will find an article from Cesare in it. So what is interesting about some of his areas of research, so there are some recurrent points of interest. So Chisori is has published a lot on Marx, beyond Marx, Marx in Crisis, and on Deleuze, Spinoza, and so just to mention a few of, I promise not to do it, but I think I have to do it nevertheless. So just to mention a few of his books. So one book is in Praise of the Common, Conversations on Philosophy and Politics, I think, which is his conversation with Antonio Negri. So it's Negri and Casarino. So it's a really celebrity match. So it's a really, really good book on philosophy and politics. So I highly recommend this. He edited a volume, which is Marxism Beyond Marxism. And, has written about sexual politics, and again about Marx, Deleuze, Spinoza. But there's one recurrent like a thread through his entire work, that he always comes back to write about Pasolini. So and you can see it. It's almost in a, I don't want to say in a 10-year cycle, but it's because it's obviously there's an ongoing interest, and it's very interesting because the perspective that he has on Pasolini very much changes according to the political thought he's pursuing at a particular time. So it's just to mention two articles that he wrote on Pasolini. The one is Oedipus Exploded, and Pasolini and the Myth of Modernization, which was published in October. And the other one is the Southern Answer, Pasolini, Universalism, Decolonization, Critical Inquiry in 2010. So tonight he will give, the title of his talk tonight will be Nation, Pigs, and Cha-Cha-Cha and Pasolini's Mamma Roma. So the two of us also share a joint interest in pigs. And it's a big pleasure to have you here, Cesare, so please take over.
Thank you, Rembert. Thank you very much for this introduction, and I would like to thank also, many thanks really, to the organizers of the series, both at the University of Frankfurt and here in the Film Museum, and who have also invited me to be here, Vincent Hedegger, Mark Siegel, Rembert Huser, Urs Spörig, Regine Prange. And many thanks to all of you for being here on such a lovely evening to come here and listen to this and watch the movie. It is truly an honor to be in Frankfurt. Sincerely, it is an honor and a pleasure. And I will go straight ahead into the lecture. I will read for about 1 hour with several clips. And then I believe we have the film in a question and answer period, correct? Yes. Anna Magnani. Anna Magnani was more than an actress, more than a star, more than a diva, more than a legend, more than a myth. Anna Magnani surpassed even the type of myth that Roland Barthes captured so elegantly in an essay like The Face of Garbo, in which Greta Garbo and Audrey Hepburn are immortalized as the most emblematic icons of two different eras in the history of cinema. Roland Barthes is only one among many semioticians, film and media scholars, as well as literary and cultural theorists, who have analyzed the elusive and alluring power of film icons. None of these, however brilliant and illuminating analysis, however, suffices to comprehend fully the immense impact that the volcanic film performances of Anna Magnani had on Italian culture after 1945, and specifically after her role as P. Pina, the defiant working-class heroine of Roberto Rossellini's 1945 film Roma Città Aperta, Rome Open City. Indeed, it was her performance as Pina, the widowed mother of one child, now pregnant with another child by a new man, Francesco, whom she loves and whom she wants to marry, that turned Anna Magnani not only into a household name, but also into what I would like to call a national allegory. I will return to the question of national allegory. For the moment, let us focus on the famous sequence that marked a watershed both in the history of cinema and in the history of Italian culture at one and the same time. The story is well known. The year is 1944. Rome is under German occupation. Pina and Francesco are going to be married in a few hours. A sudden raid on their apartment building results in the capture of Francesco, along with other members of the partisans' resistance, and in Pina's martyrdom. First clip, please. This entire sequence traces the vector of an uncontrollable, uncontainable force. Each and every one of the 22 shots of this sequence emphasizes that nothing and nobody can stop Pina in her furious, fearless, futile rush towards her love and towards her death. She overwhelms and overpowers everybody who tries to block her. Not only her enemies, the German and Italian soldiers, not only her friends, the priest who is going to marry her, the security guard who is a man of the people and who is always on the side of the people, but also her son, her child, who struggles with the soldiers trying to run after her, and even her lover, whose last word shouted from the military truck is "Tenetela," hold her, restrain her. Indeed, the soundtrack powerfully reinforces the main visual point of the sequence, namely that Pina is unstoppable. In the loud cacophony of the sequence, in which we hear Pina and Francesco screaming each other's names over the background noise of cries, murmurs, and whispers coming from the indignant crowd, the only other barely distinguishable words that we hear are Pina's angry epithet, Carogna, which she hisses at the insolent soldier whom she had slapped just a few seconds earlier, Pina yelling, Lasciatemi, let me go, while fighting to get through the main doorway of the building, the security guard's urgent pleas, Sora Pina, venite qua, sentite da me, Pina, come here, listen to me, while attempting desperately to keep her from running out into the street, the security guard's despairing last words to Pina when he realizes that all is lost. Fermatevi, stop. A word whose poignant echo is Francesco's shout from the opposite direction, that is, from the military truck. Tenetela, hold her. And it is at this point that we literally see a sound before we hear it, as the visual anticipates and complicates the oral in the image of the priest putting his hands over the child's ears so as to prevent him from hearing what the priest knows the whole world is about to hear, namely the inevitable and fatal sound of the machine gun, which is followed by the child running to and throwing himself over his mother's lifeless body while screaming, Mamma, Mamma, Mamma. In this sequence, sound and image repeatedly complement and reassert each other to index the power of an irrepressible force. Only a machine gun can finally stop Pina, but by the end of the sequence, however, what we have witnessed is not Pina's death, but Pina's unstoppable triumph. A triumph that, as we shall see, is all the more ambivalent and ambiguous precisely because it is uncontainable and unstoppable. It is this triumph that I am calling a national allegory. This is not only Pina's triumph, but also Anna Magnani's triumph, since after this sequence, Anna Magnani will be forever associated with this performance, namely with enacting a sacrifice, Pina's sacrifice, which is framed and presented as the perfect synecdoche of the innumerable sacrifices of a city and of a nation in struggle against both a foreign invader and a repressive regime. In 1945, Anna Magnani becomes the representation of a nation to itself, and hence becomes integral part of an official narrative of resistance and resurgence, integral part of a myth of origins. This is the myth of how the unspeakable sufferings, struggles, and sacrifices of the Italian nation in the end were successful in giving birth to a new country. The myth of how the new Italian Republic emerged victorious from the unbearable yoke of fascism and from the utter ruination of the war. Indeed, the proleptic co-optation and, I dare say, consecration and sanctification of Pina Anna Magnani as the mother of the new nation is already well underway in many sequences of Rome Open City. See, for example, this other sequence in which Pina and Francesco are sitting on the steps of the staircase of their apartment building on the night before their wedding, fondly reminiscing about the first time they met. Second clip, please. The shift from love to motherhood is at once seamless and jarring. Here, a heart-to-heart conversation between two lovers quickly turns into Francesco delivering a stilted, strained, yet sincere speech, jam-packed with all the corny clichés of the political rhetoric of the Popular Front, to the somewhat surprised and disappointed audience of Pina, who had brought Francesco there for some love talk and not for a third-rate inspirational sermon, but who quickly readjusts to the new role that she's being asked to play, and who appropriately sits one step below her man, looks up at him patiently, yet in awe and admiration. Only too predictably, Francesco's speech leads to Pina's pregnancy and motherhood, which are joined inextricably to the fate and the future of the nation, as her born and unborn children are declared to be the ones who will live to see the marvelous new spring after the long, hard winter of fascism and of the war. Clearly, when it comes to women, the patriarchal rhetoric of the Popular Front is not very different from the patriarchal rhetoric of fascism. For both, the immense political power of woman is to be contained, imaged, and utilized as the figure of mother of the new nation. And yet, importantly, Pina has the last word here. In reply to Francesco's injunction never to be afraid, she does protest while crying, "Sì, Francesco, ma io non ho paura, mai." "Yes, Francesco, but I'm never afraid, never." It is only on the next morning that all of us, including Francesco, will discover just how fearless she is. But why call all of this a national allegory? Why not call Anna Magnani, for example, a national symbol, the symbol of the great new nation to come? What makes matters very complicated is that Anna Magnani is both. She's at once national allegory and national symbol. Let me explain. The concept of national allegory has a long history in literary and cultural theory, especially in its Marxist varieties. For my purposes, I borrow and re-elaborate this concept most immediately from the work of Frederick Jameson, but also from the thinker who arguably produced the most important and most complex theorization of allegory since Dante Alighieri, and who was a great influence on Jameson himself, namely Walter Benjamin. There is no time to do justice to these intellectual genealogies here, and hence I will limit myself to making only two points, admittedly oversimplifying matters a great deal. One, allegory and symbol are two different yet related forms of representation that correspond to two different ways of experiencing and understanding the world. It is important to note that Benjamin's notoriously incomplete, fragmentary, and obscure theorization of allegory was developed alongside and in connection with a much clearer and much more direct critique of the theory of symbols. Benjamin's critique of symbols may be best understood as a critique of Platonism. For Benjamin, there is always something Platonic about symbols, in the sense that a symbol, for example, Anna Magnani, represents something, for example, the nation, by positing their essential identity with a third term in the eternal and transcendent realm of ideas, for example, with the ideal of nation, with what the nation is supposed to be. By contrast, allegory is far more difficult to define, precisely because it does not posit a homogeneous continuum between itself, that which it represents, and the identity with the third term. For Benjamin, the relation between an allegory and that which it represents is structurally unstable because the stabilizing third term that mediates between the two either can no longer be posited as eternal and transcendent or is lacking, tout court. This is why Benjamin, for example, argues that Charles Baudelaire, whom he considered the most important allegorical writer since the Baroque era, experienced his world of mid-19th century Paris in a way that was, quote, exactly attuned to the experience of the world that Nietzsche expressed in the sentence, God is dead, end of quote. Allegory is the form of representation that best expresses the unstable, transient, ephemeral experience of a world without God, a world that has lost an eternal and transcendent anchoring principle, namely the world of secular, capitalist modernity. Symbols have not disappeared from this world. On the contrary, symbols acquire a new significance and function in this secular modern world. They hide the event of the death of God. They hide the aleatory nature of the world in the wake of this event. In short, they conceal allegory. This is why symbol and allegory are not opposites of each other. For Benjamin, there is no dialectical relation between these two different forms of representation and their attendant experience of the world. Indeed, symbols and allegories are found most often to be immanent to each other. In a sense, we may think of the modern symbol as the ideological manifestation of an allegory that lives in the symbol and that gives it life. Strictly speaking, if one were to take Benjamin's critique of the theory of symbols to its logical conclusions, one would have to say that in modernity there is no such a thing as a symbol per se, and that a symbol is always a more or less successful attempt to hide and make invisible the social and political contradictions that an allegory makes apparent in however indirect and enigmatic ways. And just in case you think I've forgotten about the question of the nation, let me point out that the modern allegory and the modern nation-state were born roughly in the same place and at the same time, namely, in the German-speaking lands of the Holy Roman Empire in the middle of the 17th century. As you know, the peace treaties of Westphalia, which ratified the system of modern sovereignty and marked the official birth of the modern nation-state as a legal and political entity, were signed in Münster and Osnabrück in 1648, around the time when in Silesia, the likes of Andreas Gryphius, Daniel Caspar von Hohenstein were writing allegorical dramas keenly concerned with the question of sovereignty, which Benjamin analyzes in his treatise on the German Baroque, Trauerspiels. The modern allegory and the modern nation-state share in the same historical conditions of possibility and are intimately related to one another from the very start. National allegory, thus, is not an allegory like any other. In many respects, national allegory is allegory par excellence. Two. It is all of this and more that Frederick Jameson inherits from Benjamin and re-elaborates over and over again in an ongoing lifetime project that extends from the early 1960s to the present day. In a recent conversation, Jameson confessed that after all these years of thinking and writing about allegory, he no longer knows exactly what an allegory is. Still, it is Jameson who is responsible for having produced the concept of national allegory, and for having tested this concept in his analysis of the passage from modernity to postmodernity, as manifested in a vast variety of literary and cultural forms. In particular, what concerns me here is the necessary relation that Jameson posits between national allegory and what he calls a libidinal apparatus, a concept he borrows and readapts from Jean-François Lyotard. The structural instability of allegory is due to the fact that there is always an essential difference between allegory and that which it nonetheless represents. If symbols function according to a logic of transcendent identity, allegory functions according to a logic of immanent difference. It is difference, rather than identity, that constitutes the mediation between the two terms in an allegorical form of representation. This difference is in effect an excess of representation, a surplus with respect to the representational structure. If a national symbol represents a seamless and stable idea of the nation, a national allegory at once represents and destabilizes the nation by inserting a difference, by expressing a surplus. For Jameson, this surplus is specifically libidinal. Any ideological formation, such as the nation or anything else, functions only to the extent to which it is able to elicit a cathexis, to generate a libidinal investment. Once mobilized, however, such an investment is notoriously difficult to control and keep focused on any one object. And hence, the possibility of a libidinal surplus emerging and destabilizing the very ideological formation that called it into being is almost guaranteed. This is why, for Jameson, national allegory inevitably, quote, transforms itself into a libidinal apparatus, an empty form or structural matrix in which a charge of free-floating and inchoate fantasy, both ideological and psychoanalytic, can suddenly crystallize, end of quote. Jameson continues, quote, the empty matrix of national allegory is then immediately seized on by hitherto unformulable impulses which invest its structural positions, end of quote. Jameson's fortuitous turn of phrase, quote, the empty matrix of national allegory, end of quote, could not be more uncannily appropriate for the problematic that I have been articulating so far. National allegory is precisely empty matrix, empty mother, hystera. It is the exploited feminine that enables the emergence of a previously inexpressible libidinal surplus, in excess of the libidinal investment necessary to produce a cathexis on the nation. National allegory at once represents that ideological formation which is the nation and expresses that libidinal surplus which threatens to shatter the nation from the inside. We can return now to Anna Magnani and to her complex relation to the question of the nation, a relation whose complexity testifies to the difficult and uneasy immanence of symbol and allegory. If earlier I stated that Anna Magnani is both national symbol and national allegory, that is because she incarnates the explosive tension between two different ways of being a woman, which are posited as incompatible within the dominant ideological framework of Rome Open City, namely lover and mother. This tension is already palpable in the last sequence we watched, in which Pina articulates a lover's discourse that is rapidly hijacked and rerouted by Francesco towards the figure of the mother of the new nation. Here, a libidinal surplus is at once called into being, brought to visibility, as well as immediately contained by and subordinated to the question of the nation. But as I pointed out earlier, Pina nonetheless has the last word in this sequence. She is fearless. And it is precisely the fact that she is fearless, and hence unstoppable and uncontainable, that in the end tilts the balance in favor of a libidinal surplus that radically destabilizes and puts into question the nation and its ideological imaginaries. Let us re-examine, in fact, the sequence of Pina's martyrdom, sacrifice, and death. The first one we saw, right? The sequence of Pina's triumph. What does exactly Pina think she's doing when she suddenly sees Francesco being dragged away by the soldiers and runs after him, all the while screaming his name? What does she want to achieve by acting in this way? Is she really hoping to liberate him? Is she thinking at all? One might plausibly argue that she acts on an impulse, heedless of whatever consequence. This is true enough, and yet she cannot but be aware of the consequence of her, however, impulsive act. Everything we know about Pina leaves no doubt about the fact that she's perfectly aware that in running after Francesco, she's running towards assured death. Clearly, she would rather die than watch the love of her life being taken to prison or worse without doing anything at all. But let us pause for a moment on this self-evident interpretation of Pina's act. Let us rewind and let us perform a thought experiment. Pina is pregnant with Francesco's child, as well as already mother of a child. These are the children who, according to Francesco, will live to see a better future and hence who make her and mark her as the mother of the new nation. It is entirely plausible to imagine a quite different sequence following the moment when Pina sees Francesco being taken away. Pina is immensely distraught and yet does not run after Francesco and towards sure death, precisely to save her unborn child and to prevent her other child from becoming an orphan. This would be certainly a far more practical course of action, also because Pina knows very well that if she runs after Francesco, she will probably die without being able to liberate Francesco anyway. In the real sequence, however, Pina's impulse is not to protect her children and hence to fulfill her role of mother. Her impulse, rather, is the impulse of a lover. Let's put it bluntly. In this situation, Pina doesn't give a fuck about her children. In this sequence, it is not only the case that she's completely unconcerned with her pregnancy. It is also the case that she does not pay any attention to or even notice her son, her child, as he struggles against the soldiers trying to run after her into the street. Pina's sacrifice is not at all a sacrifice for the nation. On the contrary, what Pina sacrifices here is precisely what might have turned her into the mother of the new nation. Her entire body propelled forward as she runs with her right arm raised straight up in the air, Pina leaves her children, her motherhood, and the nation behind without the slightest hesitation in order to assert and embrace another truth, a lover's truth, even at risk of death. May I have the still, please? As she falls dead onto the ground, and her child throws himself onto her body while screaming "Mamma," that is, while desperately trying to interpolate her as the mother that she has not been to him during the sequence, a low angle shot, obscenely exposes her torn stockings all the way up to the top of her thigh and almost into her pubis, where a couple of small ribbons stand as cruel reminders of the fact that this is a sexual body of a woman who was about to marry and who might have been looking forward to a night of sex and lovemaking. As national symbol cracks under the internal pressures and contradictions of a national allegory, and as a national allegory becomes the empty matrix for previously inexpressible impulses, Anna Magnani emerges here as the indomitable libidinal surplus that at once produces and exceeds the nation that points to an altogether different and as yet unimaginable world to come. Could you please put the still away? Thank you. In 1962, when Pierpaolo Pasolini decides to cast Anna Magnani as the protagonist of a film titled Mamma Roma, he is willy-nilly claiming the complex inheritance of Rossellini's Rome Open City and making an intervention into the aesthetic, cultural, social, and political ideologies of the cinema of neorealism. What is the nature of this intervention? Mamma Roma is the story of a middle-aged prostitute with petty bourgeois aspirations, whose nom de guerre is Mamma Roma, and who decides to make a break with her past and to find a respectable job as a vegetable seller in a market so as to be able to devote herself fully to her adolescent son and to ensure him a better life than she had. Nothing works out. Nothing works out how she had hoped, as her past returns to haunt her and her son spirals downwards into a life of petty crime and eventually dies in prison. Pasolini seizes on the symbolic, allegorical, and libidinal tensions articulated in Rome Open City, already with the name of the eponymous protagonist of his film. At once mother, prostitute, and named after the capital of the nation, Mamma Roma is a figure of irreconcilable ideological interpolations. Who is Mamma Roma? Is she the mother who at once gives birth and symbolizes the capital of the nation? Is she the prostitute whose name in effect constitutes a comment on the capital of the nation and on its mercenary, meretricious, murderous, obscene, and suffered history? Is she the prostitute who allegorizes the capital of the nation to the point of exceeding history altogether and reaching all the way back into the timeless realms of ancient myth? I am sure you are familiar with the myth of origins of the Eternal City, namely the myth of how Romulus and Remus, the twin brothers who founded Rome and who fought over its foundation till one killed the other, were raised and suckled by a she-wolf. The Latin word for she-wolf, of course, is lupa, a word that in Latin also meant whore. Symbol, allegory, myth, mother, whore, and much more. Mamma Roma truly is an empty matrix, and never has an empty matrix been so crammed and bursting with conflicting representations. Never has an empty matrix been so excessive, so overfull. But let us see exactly how Pasolini at once inherits, refigures, and refills this empty matrix. I will begin from the very end of Mamma Roma, in which Pasolini presents us with a remarkable remake of the sequence of Pina's death in Rome Open City. This is the last sequence of Mamma Roma, when Mamma Roma has just learned about the death of her son, Ettore, while she's at work, surrounded by all her friends and fellow sellers in the market. Next clip, please. Paradoxically, if Pina's death is a triumph, Mamma Roma's near escape from death and enduring life at the end of this film are nothing short than a complete catastrophe. In this sequence, the echoes, correspondences, and repetitions are evident, yet secondary, as they have the effect of emphasizing rather than bridging the enormous abyss separating these two women, these two films, and indeed these two historical conjunctures. Once again, Anna Magnani screams out loud the name of her only passion, but here it is Ettore the son, while there was Francesco the lover. Once again, Anna Magnani struggles through, breaks free, runs to her death, but there she was stopped only in and by death, while here she stopped just before death, and hence she's condemned to life. And while there, her unstoppable rush was stopped by machine gun, here she stopped and saved from sure death by her son, or more precisely, by her son's relics. In a stunning reversal of the shot in which Pina's son throws himself over his dead mother's body, here Mamma Roma's rush towards the window is brought to a sudden halt by a one-second point-of-view shot as she catches a sideways glance of her son's empty clothes, upon which she throws herself onto the bed, clutching them, pressing them against her breast in a gesture that is as desperate as it is erotic, fetishistic, and incestuous. It is this brief detour that allows her friends to catch up with her, barge into the room, catch her in the act, prevent her from jumping off the window. There, it was the son grasping after an unreachable and absent mother who had chosen the love of her life over him. Here, it is the mother grasping after that unreachable, impossible, one and only love of her life who was her son. In the passage from the lover to the son, Anna Magnani traces the trajectory of a profound historical defeat. If Pina registers the tensions between two competing ideologies of womanhood, namely between the role of mother and the role of lover, and decidedly chooses the latter over the former. Likewise, Mamma Roma is torn between two incompatible and irreconcilable subject positions, namely mother and prostitute, and just as decidedly chooses the former over the latter. Throughout the entire film, Mamma Roma is firmly determined to leave her past as prostitute behind her and to redefine herself as mother only, even as her past continuously returns to disrupt her present resolution through no fault of her own. The problem is that, as the ancient myth understood only too well, to be a mother and to be a prostitute in this context are only apparently irreconcilable roles. The truth is that Mamma Roma is never given any real choice in this film. And not because her past comes back to haunt her, but because the only two roles that are available to her are essentially identical. Both motherhood and prostitution are posited here as two different manifestations of the same patriarchal structure, as two variations on the same theme. As we will see, it is Mamma Roma herself who acknowledges explicitly the essential identity of these two roles in the first sequence of the film, in which, having finally freed herself from her pimp, she promptly declares that her son is her new pimp. The tension, thus, is not between two objectively competing ideologies, like it was in the case in Rome Open City. Rather, the ideological contradiction here is completely subjectivized. That is, it is internalized and incorporated in Mamma Roma, who, on the one hand, knows perfectly well that there is no significant difference between these two types of pimp, and yet, on the other hand, chooses and sacrifices everything for the son as pimp, as if this would really make all the difference in the world. In short, Pina knows what she wants, while Mamma Roma does not, as she's fated to fall victim to her own false consciousness. The message could not be clearer. Mamma Roma has only herself to blame. And indeed, she's punished for her craving of respectability, for her petty bourgeois aspirations, and for her absolute rejection of any type of working class consciousness, as well as of communism. At a certain point in the film, Mamma Roma berates her son for spouting what to her is communist propaganda. Isn't there something profoundly reactionary, patronizing, misogynistic, and cruel in this fateful turn of events, in this passage from Pina to Mamma Roma, as if the possibility of love outside, over and beyond the false choice between mother and prostitute, is structurally unimaginable and always already foreclosed from the standpoint of this fated, ruined woman? Mamma Roma is a ruin. She's the ruin of the symbol of the nation, the ruin of the ideal that the nation was supposed to fulfill in 1945. She's the allegory of a nation once again in ruins, the allegory of what the nation has become by the year 1962. In the sequence we just watched, immediately after she has broken free from the people who are trying to hold her, there is a one-second take in which Mamma Roma is shot from behind in mid-frame, while running away from the camera down the street, and while the typical coat of market sellers flutters onto her sides and around her body like a pair of wings and makes her look as if she's about to take flight. In the meantime, in the far background, framed on each side by the vertical lines of contemporary apartment buildings, there stands horizontally the ruin of an ancient Roman aqueduct. Benjamin wrote some of his best pages showing how the figure of the ruin stands as the most emblematic allegorical trope of the German Baroque. And one could add that, especially in the visual arts, the ruin is a very important common thread running through the entire early modern period, both before and after the Baroque. Namely, from the German High Renaissance of Albrecht Dürer, whose works Benjamin also discusses in relation to the question of allegory, all the way up to and including the Italian neoclassicism of Giovanni Battista Piranesi, whose etchings of ancient Roman ruins, including aqueducts, are echoed several times in Pasolini's film. But if the ruin was the allegory par excellence of the Baroque era, and possibly of the entire early modern period, it was the prostitute, according to Benjamin, that constituted the crucial allegorical figure for Baudelaire and for his representations of mid-19th century Paris and of its emerging commodity culture. The prostitute, the ruined woman, the woman as ruin, becomes the perfect allegory for the impermanence of experience under the ubiquitous spell of the commodity form and under the tyranny of capitalist exchange relations. The depth of field of this one-second shot, thus, is not spatial. Rather, it is temporal and historical, as Pasolini manages to frame ruin, prostitute, and nation in an allegorical constellation that comprehends and juxtaposes the contemporary late modern, the mid-modern, the early modern, as well as antiquity. In this shot, Mamma Roma, who has lost her son, who hence is no longer a mother, who is now only the prostitute she always was, runs back in time and through past history, not only towards the ancient origin of her figuration, but also further back, as she's running towards final ruination and death. In an uncanny reversal of Benjamin's famous angel of history, whose face is turned towards the past, in which he sees only ruins upon ruins, but whose wings are caught in the storm of progress that irresistibly propels him toward the future, Mamma Roma becomes here the whore of history, who is chewed up and spit out by the storm of progress back into the past, and who plunges back into that history of catastrophe whence she came. It is indeed the question of progress that is at stake here. In the late 1950s and early 1960s, a period that went down in Italian history as the years of the economic miracle, during which the country joined the club of fully industrialized nations, Pasolini was one of the very few intellectuals of any persuasion, including those of communist persuasion, who pointed to the increasing numbers of the urban lumpen proletariat and to the squalor of the growing slums in which they lived as the reverse side of economic development, as the waste product of a vision of progress as industrial modernization that was celebrated both by right-wing apologists of capital and by communist comrades and fellow travelers alike. The Italian Communist Party and the communist unions, after all, derived their considerable power from the organized industrial working class and to a lesser extent from the peasantry, but had little hold on and little interest in a lumpen proletariat that was seen as either politically reactionary or completely apolitical, and hence as beyond hope. Pasolini's poetry and novels of the 1950s, as well as first films of the early to mid-1960s, especially Acatone, La Ricotta, Mamma Roma, and Uccellacci Uccellini, were all complementary pieces of a phase in Pasolini's work that was focused on the question of the lumpen proletariat, understood as evidence of all the betrayed promises of 1945, namely as proof of triple failure of industrial modernization, of democratic politics, and of the national project tout court. For more than a decade, Pasolini immersed himself in this messy and noisy universe of prostitutes, pimps, and petty criminals in the paradoxical attempt to represent what Jacques Rancière has called la part des sans-parts, les comptes des incomptés, namely the part of those who have no part in any national and political project, the count of those who are not counted and who are not accounted for in the official polity and in official politics. If I call Pasolini's attempt paradoxical and even impossible, that is because les sans-parts and les incomptés are, by definition, politically as well as aesthetically unrepresentable. But in the attempt to represent that unrepresentable underside of the national project, what Pasolini registers nonetheless is a libidinal surplus. Unlike in Rome Open City, however, this is not the libidinal surplus in excess of the libidinal investment necessary to produce a cathexis on the nation. This is not the libidinal surplus of the nation that threatens to shatter the nation from the inside. Rather, this is the libidinal surplus of that which structurally cannot be incorporated in the national project in any way whatsoever. Mamma Roma, thus, is not only the focus of divergent forms of representation of the nation, namely the symbol of the ruin of the nation and the allegory of a nation once again in ruins. Mamma Roma is also the empty matrix of a potentially far more explosive libidinal surplus that stands to destabilize, disrupt, and sabotage representation as such. Which finally brings me to pigs and cha-cha-cha. I will end this lecture by commenting on the very beginning of the film, as well as by tuning your ears to three diegetic songs that constellate to index this explosive libidinal surplus, or more precisely, to index the failure of representation in the face of such a surplus. Next clip, please. It is Anna Magnani's legendary laughter that opens this film by providing the sound bridge that carries us from the darkness of the black frame into the light and into the field of vision. After which, the first 8-second shot of the film begins. Here are three cute little pigs, all dressed up in mid-frame, against the background of the legs and dress of a woman who laughs out loud while ushering the grunting, oinking, bewildered animals with a broom inside and through a door. Before Mamma Roma, there was Mamma Circe. Who is this woman, in fact, if not Circe, 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 the treacherous witch who transforms men into pigs, the paradigmatic and threatening figure of feminine excess and female sexuality in Homer's Odyssey? And who exactly are these pigs? The next few seconds in the sequence answer this question in ways that are indirect and ambiguous, as well as very difficult to translate. Mamma Circe introduces the pigs to the wedding party of her ex-pimp, Carmine, and his bride, Clementina. Ecco nostri fratelli, here are our brothers. Carmine's sarcastic response to this carnivalesque, swinish invasion is wrongly translated in the English subtitles. Sì, fratelli d'Italia. You are right, brothers of Italy. To which Mamma Roma's mocking and disdainful rebuttal is, A ti, io te saluto, ma quale Italia è? Greetings to you. What the hell are you talking about? What Italy? Or what Italy are you talking about? Indeed, what does Italy have anything to do with this farcical vignette? But Mamma Roma continues defiantly, turns to the pigs themselves, and almost apologetically tells them, Qui fanno finta di non conoscerti. They are pretending they don't know you. After which, she gives it another try and proceeds to introduce the pigs, more specifically to the embarrassed Clementina. Ah, Clementi, te presenti tu cognati? Clementi, let me introduce you to your brothers-in-law. And then, more properly, politely, she introduces them by name. The two boys, Peppe, Nicola, and the girl, who turns out to be a whore, and whose name is Regina. Queen. And whose name, obviously, has important religious and social significance as Regina Celi. Queen of Heaven, is at once one of the appellations and attributes of the Virgin Mary, as well as the name of an infamous prison in the center of Rome, with which all these characters are very well acquainted. What has just happened in this rapid exchange of witty double entendres, innuendos, and repartees? Mamma Roma seems to be saying to Carmine and to all concerned, mutato nomine de te, fabula, narrator. She introduces all of us to these three little pigs, two of which are male, one of which is female, and a whore. These are barely disguised figures for Mamma Roma and her two pimps, namely her son and Carmine himself. Carmine immediately understands and promptly rejects the thinly veiled meaning of this cabaret act and tries to discredit it and to deflect it entirely onto the nation, brothers of Italy. The point is that Mamma Roma categorically excludes the possibility that these swinish allegories of herself and her pimps could have anything to do with Italy, and especially with that most official of national songs, which is never heard, but which resonates silently throughout the opening sequence of the film, and which is the Italian national anthem, to which Carmine explicitly and pointedly refers. A patriotic, pre-unification, mid-19th century song adopted as the official post-fascist national anthem in 1946, whose title is Il Canto degli Italiani, the Song of Italians, and whose first words are, precisely, Fratelli d'Italia, Brothers of Italy. Further, when Mamma Roma introduces the pigs, specifically to Clementina, who, like everybody else in her family, is a peasant hick from the countryside, she introduces them no longer as our brothers, but as your brothers-in-law. Clearly, the peasant hicks belong to a different family and to a different universe altogether. In short, Mamma Roma opens the film by emphasizing unequivocally that she, her pimps, and their universe are les sans part. Even though throughout the rest of the film, she's shown struggling and striving in vain to have and to play a part in a national project that had always already excluded her, her excess, her surplus. Against the silent yet loudly eloquent background of the Italian national anthem, the film soon will present us with a bitter rivalry between two other songs. More than a song per se, the first of the two is at once a musical theme and a dance, which was wildly popular at the time, namely the cha-cha-cha. We hear the cha-cha-cha faintly for the first time when Mamma Roma and her adolescent son cross the arcade that opens onto the courtyard of their apartment building. This is an important day. Mamma Roma has gone to the countryside to reclaim her son and to bring him into the city and to their new home. It is in their new home that the rival song is immediately introduced. Violino Zigano, Gypsy Violin, a tango that is very close to Mamma Roma's heart and that she tries to teach how to dance to her awkward, clumsy son in a sequence that is at once funny, touching, poignant, as well as highly erotic and incestuous, especially when we learn that her attachment to the song has everything to do with the fact that the one who used to sing it for her was no other than her son's father. As we quickly realize, however, the son is not very interested in the old-fashioned tango, which he had never heard of. But he's certainly very keen to learn how to dance the fashionable cha-cha-cha, which had already reached even the remote peasant provinces from which he has just arrived. From this moment onwards in the film, these two songs are pitted against each other in a constantly repeated duel that is first and foremost libidinal and sexual. Whereas the tango is immediately associated with adult heterosexuality. In fact, the cha-cha-cha, slowly but surely, will eventually come to be identified with homosexuality, thereby putting forth the suggestion that unbeknownst to her mother, and perhaps even to himself, her son may be homosexual. I will not trace and discuss the intricate twists and turns of the complex duel between these two songs throughout the film. Aside from alerting you and inviting you to pay attention to this duel while watching the film, here I am more interested in considering the important historical provenance of these two songs. It is crucial to know, in fact, that Violino Zigano, Gypsy Violin, was an immensely popular fascist-era song, composed in 1934 for a film whose title could not have been less subtle, Melodramma. One of those fascist-era films that will go down in history as telefoni bianchi, white telephone films, usually light romantic comedies or melodramas. Put differently, from the standpoint of Pasolini's film, this song is historically and politically tainted from the very start, much like Mamma Roma, with whom it is indissolubly associated. In the film, the song at best marks for Mamma Roma a site of nostalgia for a past of love that could have been but that never was. One might think then that the cha-cha-cha emerges victorious here, given its subtle yet distinct association with homosexuals and homosexuality, as well as with a possibly homosexual boy who dies unjustly in prison and who is so similar to the real-life hoodlums of the lumpen proletariat, whom Pasolini infamously consorted with for sex and much else, given such associations, it would stand to reason that it is this sexually charged, seductive, and exotic dance song that rings the only utopian note, pointing to an altogether different concept of the nation and to a world yet to come, in a film that is otherwise implacable in shutting down any possibility of redemption for anything and anyone. And yet, the cha-cha-cha too must have been historically and politically problematic for Pasolini. Emerging from the swinging dance halls of mid-1950s pre-revolutionary Cuba that Fulgencio Batista had turned into a playground for wealthy Americans, the cha-cha-cha could not have had an immaculate political record for Pasolini, the self-avowed yet heretical communist who, in 1962, 3 years after Fidel Castro and his troops had stormed Havana, and 1 year after Cuba had joined the non-aligned movement, was already very attentive and sympathetic to the emergent anti-imperialist and anti-colonial movements worldwide. In short, nothing works here. Three different songs, three different ways of riffing on the nation, three different failures. If the constellation of these three songs indexes the explosive and unrepresentable libidinal surplus of all that structurally cannot be incorporated in the nation, that is so not because this constellation is able to represent the surplus. Rather, this musical constellation indicates the presence of the surplus precisely in failing to represent it, precisely in constituting a failure of representation in the face of such a surplus. These three songs, just like the entire film, are circling and dancing around a national, political, and sexual void. Here, in this void, something happens that is not only unrepresented and unrepresentable by the film, but also unthinkable and unimaginable for Pasolini himself. What is it that haunts Pasolini here and elsewhere? As a provocation, let me suggest that what Pasolini struggles to think and to imagine, but was never able to express or to live in any way, is the integration and incorporation of communism and homosexuality. How can one possibly be both a communist and a homosexual? This is the silent, unspoken, yet ubiquitous question that I hear in everything Pasolini ever did. A question whose answer in this film seems to be the impossible fantasy of a nation, indeed of a world, of cute, dancing, communist, homosexual pigs. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this great lecture. And your applause. I think we will have a short break. Wir werden eine kleine Pause machen von 10 Minuten. Wie Sie es kennen, das Filmcafé hat auch noch geöffnet, wenn Sie sich noch mit einem Getränk für den Film ausstatten möchten. Und durch den Gong werden wir signalisieren, wenn es gleich losgeht. Bis gleich.
First of all, still a big thank you for your brilliant talk. And I think there are certain talks that have such an energy that one has to pace around the way how you did it. So, and I want to open up the discussion right away. So, and are there first questions with respect to some of the arguments that Cesare made? So you actually made a you fast forwarded us through so many things from neorealism to the situation of 1962. To the readings of allegory and symbol, and so are there first questions here?
Okay, then give me just a sign, okay.
Yep.
Yeah, thank you very much for the talk, Cesare, I appreciate it very much. And I was thinking about, I thought was a scene that was very much along what you tried to say, I think, in the comparison of the two films, and that was in the latter part of the film, in the kitchen when the pimp is coming back for the second time and she's attacking him with a knife, and he's throwing her down to the ground, and it's almost looking like it's the same position, like in the Rossellini. Film, and then he's saying, "Don't act like a crazy woman. It would end, or it will end up bad for one of us, or something like that." And I mean, it fitted perfectly well. But I was thinking about the what kind of position does he have there when he's saying it might end up for him badly? Of course, he can be attacked by the knife, but I mean, there's also another sense, I guess. Do you have anything? Or how would you comment on that scene?
Well, I would say, first of all, of course you're right, I think it is a direct reference to the scene in Rossellini's film. And I would like to add that that very scene is repeated yet again towards the end of Mamma Roma, because of course, like father, like son. The son does the same thing to Bruna when he pushes her towards the end, when he already is ill and clearly is angry that he has discovered his mother was a whore or still is a whore, and so on and so forth. So it's repeated twice in this I think that's important that it's repeated twice. That is, there are two references in Mamma Roma to that moment in Rossellini's film. I think it's important because precisely because it has to do with the father and the son. Though we don't know for sure that, of course, Carmine is Ettore's father, but the hint is that. I don't know what else to say other than the fact that this does reinforce the link between the two films, but precisely in this inverse way, in the sense that where in Rossellini there is something that escapes the role that Pina is being pushed into, and the role there is a sexual role, a sexual body. So there is something actually quite how can I put it? There is something in Rossellini's version of this, there is something quite subversive. Whereas here in Mamma Roma, as I said in the talk at one point, Mamma Roma never has any chance. In fact, none of the women do. Perhaps one could say nobody does. But so it is a reference to the film, to Rossellini, but once again inverted with that. And I think the Carmine's words, one of us is going to end up badly, are precisely a commentary on that. He's certainly meaning, I'm not going to be one. It's going to be you.
Yeah, I was thinking that at the end one could say that she's punished for what she did in the Rossellini by not thinking of her son kind of as a figure. But in that scene, she's even degraded as a national allegory because when he says, you're acting like a crazy woman, and it's really, so it's pretty hard.
It is, and you're right. I mean, the... I think it's very complicated because at some level there is a question of representation. One could say the film is representing the fact that this woman is punished by everything in life. But on top of that, I also think that there is something about the film itself that punishes her. There's a double punishment going on. It's not just the representation of a punishment. There's actually also willful degradation of this woman. But that's because I think Pasolini's interest ultimately lies elsewhere, in another type of libidinal surplus that cannot even quite emerge, if not in some bits and pieces, fragmentary via the songs and via a few other moments. So I think, yes, she's been punished. It's Magnani here that is being punished for what she did as Pina, right?
Could you also say a little bit about the tropes of architecture in this film? So after listening to your talk and seeing the film afterwards, I had the impression that there's also a symbolic reading of architecture and an allegoric one, which pretty much enforce the argument that you do, and that this, especially because you were focusing on the architecture of the rune as for the allegoric moment, And if you think about the very structure of the aqueduct, then it also it presents a frame by frame representation that fails because the aqueduct is also not intact anymore. So at the same time, you have, in addition to the national discourse, also a discourse on film, where the symbolic architecture of the city in the distance that one never approaches. The national concept of immediacy, legibility, and this kind of dreamlike state is permanently counterbalanced by the allegorical thing.
This is extremely complex. I mean, the architectural, the level of the architectural in the film, I think, is extremely complex. First of all, regarding the aqueducts themselves, the ruins of the aqueducts. So you will remember that in the very last, well, the sequence before the last, potato seller, in order to try and console Mamma Roma, says, you know, it's water that passes, which is a colloquial expression for saying, he'll get over it. The kid will go to jail, he'll get over it, he'll come out, and so on. But that's what the aqueduct is, right? It's the water that passes, but it's broken. In fact, this water doesn't pass, doesn't go through. So there is that scheme of reference at the end. But then I think the much more complex thing is the fact that it's the location of most of the location of the shootings are in this no man's lands. I mean, there are the classic of trope that Deleuze refers to as espace quelconque in his cinema studies, in cinema books. I mean, this nowhere, no man's land that are, in fact, historically multi-layered. So we have the expanding city with all that means in terms of an industrialized nation. We have the ancient ruins. And we have on the background always some sheep, shepherds. There is still the countryside. And it's a very difficult to notice, but the very last shot of the film, which is this image that actually recurs several times, in fact, I think seven times, the last shot of the film with the apartment building, this new church with the dome. The last shot has in the far right corner a field and a peasant working on it. Tiny, 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 tiny figure. So this is part of the architectural, because it's literally a setting, a stage. All these sequences are within this architectural setting where the urban meets the countryside, the agricultural meets herding culture, even older, where the hicks meet the, it's a nexus. And this is a nexus of different modes of production. And that nexus is expressed primarily through the architecture and through the space.
Just very briefly, as you were talking about the architecture, there is also the architecture we don't see, the one that Magnani describes as she's walking, in that the fascist architecture, right? Her first, in a way, pimp, the man she's married to, and here the prostitute, the mother, the wife all come together, was at least allegedly an architect who sold out to Mussolini and to the regime. So there is also that invisible
right,
architecture,
right.
Which
absolutely.
Is sustaining.
Absolutely, I hadn't thought of that. You're absolutely right.
No, just but very yeah. briefly. And then two comments, maybe there is a question in what I'm about to say. You invited us to, in a way, imagine what could, what if Pina hadn't died? What if she'd been restrained? In a way, I think you were maybe already suggesting, but I don't want to put words in your mouth, that this is the film. Pina didn't die. Pina, when Pina didn't die, this is what became of her. That in a way, if we give precedence to the actress and not to the director, this is Magnani's second act as the Pina who didn't die. In 45, and of course the age is a bit messed up, but that's maybe a suggestion. I don't know how compatible would be or resonant with what you think, but I certainly like to hear about it. And then the second comment, maybe more of a question about the surplus. You were speaking about homosexuality and communism, how they can get together, and I immediately thought of your work on the common, the surplus common, and so surplus, not surplus value, but a surplus as common, being perhaps in terms of theoretical practice, what can bring communism and homosexuality together many years after the after Pasolini made the film and died.
All right. Regarding the first comment, the only thing I can say is that I completely agree with you. In effect, one could construct an interpretation of this film, of Mamma Roma, as a sequel to Rome Open City had Pina not died. This is the film we get in Pasolini's, you know, from Pasolini's standpoint. We could have gotten many other films, but this is one Pasolini is able and willing to. So that there, I completely agree. Regarding the second point, which you'll have to remind me of. Yes, the surplus. Okay, so let me go back to something that I said a moment to Verena's question. I said Pasolini's interests lie elsewhere. This elsewhere can hardly be registered in the film. Let me be more specific about that, because since you brought it up. The elsewhere is certainly not homosexuality. That's not what I mean. Pasolini is perfectly able to represent, register homosexual desire, and almost always, almost like 99% is male homosexual desire specifically. What he cannot imagine, and that still is registered here as a void, is precisely the combination between a certain idea or ideal, even, of communism and male homosexual desire. Now, another word for surplus is a void. So this is, in a sense, when I said that all these songs and the entire film is dancing around this void, the void is full, and it's full of something that cannot be registered other than by being pointed at as there is something there. And that something there has to do with, yes, it has to do with a common, because there are figurations of being in common in this film, that very, very powerful. They're usually among the prostitutes. They are the market sellers. But each and every time that happens, in sexual terms, they're very strictly heterosexually coded. But for the exception of the first long tracking shot when she's coming out and she has actually said goodbye to prostitution, when we have the group of fairly ridiculed male homosexuals, we can't understand if they're prostitutes or if they're just hanging out there, because that's probably one of the few places where they can hang out. That's the only exception, but it is stereotyped and ridiculed. So what's unimaginable here is that there could be solidarity among homosexuals, solidarity of the type of a common. That's the surplus that this movie is kind of hitting against itself.
So does it mean that solidarity is communism? Or as another question, Why is it a combination of homosexuality and communism?
To the first point, I certainly am not saying that solidarity and communism are the same, but I personally cannot imagine, I cannot have any idea of communism without solidarity. Okay, so for me that's a ground zero of anything that could construct a common. It would be something of human solidarity. The second point is why this combination, homosexuality, communism? Well, that's much more difficult to say. I feel that it is at the level of Pasolini's Bildung. It is his own split, and I don't want to psychoanalyze Pasolini or talk about Pasolini as a person. I want to talk about this as a body of work. The split is between, on the one hand, wanting to continue an allegiance to an idea of communism, even in the face of plenty of communisms that are failing, and on the other hand, wanting to express a male homosexual desire in an open way. The work, the body work, is really split between this tension. Now, do these things have something necessary to do with each other? In general terms, not necessarily. But in order to understand Pasolini's work, yes, they do have something to do with each other. There is something profound that, in fact, ties the two. One could even think that there is something, something slightly, something having to do with male homosociality in terms of a certain type of democratic ideal, fraternité, brotherhoods, etc. So there is something ultimately rather sexist about this combination or tension in Pasolini. All I'm saying is that these two questions in this body of work are intimately tied up with each other. They're not intimately tied up in general for all times and for every place, but here they are through Pasolini.
Thanks very much.
Clearly, I don't have an answer that is yet fully for myself, but that's the tension.
Thanks very much for your talk. I have two questions. One is referring to the music. The other one is referring to the issue of architecture again. You were referring to the issue of no man's land, but rather much, I would say, the whole movie is about gates, yeah, about prisons. I mean, if you look at it from the beginning to the end, you know, the windows, the window is at the end. You have the door opening in the beginning. You have rather much, as you know, of course, the no man's land is framed, right, by the city and so on. Yeah, and you have all the time changing from one place to the other place.
You even have Bruna, the totally. Bruna telling him, "That's my window, the window of my house. Can you see?" Now you see a thousand windows that all look the same.
But
right?
Even the place where they make love is, of course, it's like a cell too. So the whole structure, you know, you have to encapsulate that. You all know that. So maybe you want to further elaborate on this. The second point is, or connected with that first point, is that of course, that's all dealing with the issue of violence, of what Marx would call ursprüngliche Akkumulation, yeah, you know, Landnahme, mm-hmm. and so on. So that's clearly Marxist. The second point is, when you were talking about the music, you were focusing a bit much, from my point of view, about the cha-cha-cha tango stuff. But that's not liberating, really. I mean, that's part of the culture industry. That's not innocent music, as we know. You know, it frames you, it arrests you, like the gates and so on. What really could liberate you is, of course, the laughter and the whistling. Okay, there are three scenes of whistling in the movie. The first one is already a comment on what the pimp says, Camille says. The second time it's taken over by the sun, right next, and then this is like it's like a counterbalancing the music score in the movie. And the third time he's whistling, again, it's a comment by the son, who's grown up, again, the talk with the salesman, you know. He knows that the salesman tells him all kinds of bullshit. And he comments with a whistling on it and keeps on whistling until he meets Bruna. The other option is, of course, as you said, I mean, the beautiful laughter by Anna Magnani. I mean, as you know, Hobbes and so on, what he says about laughter. I mean, this is insubordination. It's not allowed in honor society to do this, okay? And if you, I mean, there's so many things you could say about laughter, but this isn't that the liberating point? And isn't that exactly what the problem is, that you cannot voice in proper terms what you have to say unless you're Marxist?
There is certainly much more regarding the soundtrack that is important and that needs to be talked about. The whistling definitely is part of it. There are also other important songs, but we can leave that aside. Now, the whistling is an interesting, and of course there are the songs at the beginning of the wedding, right? This is a very traditional Roman, and there are different versions of this in southern Italy, of a folk tradition of rhymed songs that are improvised and that are really agonistic. There is this kind of competition between players. So there are many differing things that are important in the soundtrack. Not the least of all, also the Vivaldi concerto, which was explicitly put there so as to counter the fact that in Pasolini's first film, Acatone, the music there is Bach. And most critics found the jarring juxtaposition of, you know, the story of pimps with this high classical music, not only jarring but also nonsensical. So Pasolini went to Vivaldi because, very specifically, he said, it's much more like pop music. They will like this better. Now, this links up with exactly your comment. There's nothing liberating here about the cha-cha-cha, about the gypsy, the gypsy song, the violino gypsy violin, the violino zigano, and so on. I thought, however, that was my point at the end of my talk, was none of this works. They all are trying to index an idea of liberation in very different ways, but none of it works. This is why I feel that what's more important here is the constant, repeated failures of representation in the film, rather than what the film is trying to represent. So at that level, I completely agree. Now, regarding laughter, of course, much to say there. I would want to go in theoretical terms, really. Bataille might be most appropriate in terms of exactly the rupture of the symbolic order here. But this is precisely why, in some weird sense, this is a failed film, which Pasolini himself admitted, probably from the wrong reasons. Anna Magnani cannot be contained. And it is a problem for this film. It is a problem for a filmmaker and an intellectual who, in fact, wants to put everything in cages. He is very much about framing his topic in a very controlled way. Anna Magnani cannot play that. She just couldn't. I don't think it was in her capabilities to be contained. And hence the tension. And here, this is one of those films where the tension between the director and the actress is, it's not just a question of performance, precisely because Anna Magnani is not just an actress. There is something structural here about the fact that she's uncontainable that makes the film, in a sense, flawed. And Pasolini regretted greatly, and said so publicly, regretted having cast Anna Magnani in this role, which is one of the greatest roles of her career. I mean, but
yeah, tagging on to that, actually, you know, the idea of him trying to contain Anna Magnani but not being able to do so. There is one iconographic element in the film that occurs in other Pasolini films as well, of course, the body of Christ from Mantegna, which in a way is set up in an earlier scene in the church where the young prostitute tells you know, asks Anna Magnani, would you die for him on the cross? And she said yes. And then it's the son who dies like that on the cross. And it would seem to me that this particular use of the Mantegna reference, which reoccurs in other films as well, actually ties in quite well with your argument, but I would still like to hear your comments on that.
Yes, this is an important reference. What I would say about it is that what I find most interesting in this very continuously, it's repeated at least three times, there are three sequences here, that refer to Mantegna's Lamentation of Christ. I think that's the painting you're referring to, Lamentation of Christ. Now, the thing that I find interesting is Pasolini's reshaping of that painting here. Because the Lamentation of Christ, you have exactly the same perspective. Christ has been deposed from the cross and is on the table, let's say on the table. But he's surrounded by people crying over him, which is why it's a lamentation and not a crucifixion. And prominently there is a mother crying over him. Now, where is the mother here? Where is anybody? There is nobody here. Christ is alone. And the interesting thing is that the cuts in those sequences are such that often enough we go from the kid dying or already dead, from the kid cut to the mother in the kitchen. So what in effect Pasolini does to the Mantegna painting is disassemble it, take some of the characters out of it, and specifically separating the mother and the son. And that I find, I don't know how it would fit in my argument quite, but I do find it quite intense in terms of its structure of what.
No, it's just, yes. Completely agree, but the version that I'm already, the painting that I'm referring to is the one that it's in, that is in the Brera in Milano, which is only the dead body of Christ.
No figures around it.
It's just, you know, the spectacular,
right, yes,
compressed perspective with the feet in the foreground, and which reoccurs in Decamerone.
Yes.
Where it is Pasolini himself who puts himself in that position,
yes,
and then awakes from it as the artist, by the way.
Well, I mean, I see your point. They're not mutually exclusive. Obviously, the figure of that Christ or the crucified Christ recurs, as you pointed out, in so many other things. Even in Accattone, so that's the first, but here we have one of the very first.
Okay, let me add to this, to Heidegger's question. In the Milano Mantegna, this Christ, if you look at the picture carefully, is not dismembered like here the boy. Yeah. So maybe you want to include that into your libido theory.
Right. I see what you mean. Yeah, I would have to think more about the differences here. I mean, you're right, though. Yes. Right. Thank you for pointing it out.
I'd like to ask you for another comment, because I really liked your comparison between these two films you presented us here. And I thought of Fellini's Roma, 1974, and Fellini knocks in a very little small scene at the door of Anna Magnani and tells her she is Mama Roma and tells her all the attributes. And she only says, "Oh, go home, Federico."
Yeah, go to sleep.
Yeah. How would you comment on that? as an epilogue.
And that was her last, in fact, her last, the last time she was shot. I mean, the last time she was on camera. How would I comment on that? Well, you know, it is in keeping, in a sense, with the fact that her relation to filmmakers, was one of not of dismissal, but she understood these men they are all, the ones that she's dealing with, as having another project that is different from hers. Here, the question of the laughter would have to come back majorly, because she really constructed her actorial persona around that outburst. So I would say that here, also to Fellini's credit, he's able to capture her precisely in this moment when she says, you know, you have your toys, you have your things, you do these things, but, you know, I have something else to do. And she has a different project.
I was still deliberating about what I should think about the effect of the music. I was thinking, would you say that the Vivaldi still provides the character with an element of sublimity, as in Accattone with Bach music? So maybe one could see Ettore as a kind, somehow an ideal brother of Accattone in this perspective, who ironically is playing the father, I think, in this movie.
Right. I think what I would say about the music, the Vivaldi and the Bach specifically, what is very deliberate, of course, is the juxtaposition of so-called high and low. Now, this is, had I had more time, what I wanted to talk about was the fact that in terms of allegorical writing, this is a very important question. Baudelaire became famous in poetry precisely for having being really one of the first to experiment with extremely high lyrical language interspersed with absolutely quotidian, even vulgar language. So Pasolini is working in a tradition here where, the question of the music, I think, needs to be seen within this tradition of a type of construction that puts together elements that otherwise were never put together, elements of the high and of the low, elements from mass culture, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, so it is within that context that I would frame it. I don't think that there is anything more, say, spiritual about Vivaldi or the Bach or anything else for that matter. I think the important point is not in the music itself, but the important point is in the juxtaposition with radically different types of music and environments. In other words, there is no essence to Bach's music as far as these films go, or Vivaldi's music. There isn't something that they are its function is precisely in being juxtaposed to something that is radically different.
I didn't understand the Christian symbolic system of the film, because right at the beginning there was the Last Supper, and at the end there was the crucifixion. And the only thing I was understanding was through the music. It was, for me, the music was, but almost the whole music was, give me the feeling of a melancholic basement. Was through, mm-hmm. through Vivaldi or through the gypsy violin. Was really, I was really feeling melancholic. There was nothing happy. There was no happy music making feeling happy. So,
well, there was the cha-cha-cha, of course.
The cha-cha-cha at the beginning, but then it was really fun. The whole film was really melancholic. But
yes,
I don't didn't understand the Christian symbolicity between.
Let me start there. The Christian symbolism that is strewn throughout, there are so many. One could talk about this at length. In my opinion, it's a mishmash, meaning that it is, in fact, a rather incoherent putting together of different Christian symbolic references. Now, one could, so if you say, I didn't understand it, well, there is a good reason for that. It's not coherent. I don't think it is coherent, not in this film. There is a continuous throwing of Christian symbolisms at the audience. But I personally don't think that there is a coherent schema that links them all. The importance, however, continuously, is to associate Christian symbols with the lowest of the low, with pimps, with whores, etc., etc. That's a constant throughout. But in terms of the specific, I don't think there is an overarching argument. Perhaps there is. I'm sure it could be made. I don't see it. Now, one could and should think about, why is this so? Is this, let's call it incoherence, willed? Or is it a question that he's experimenting? It is his second film, after all, right? He's experimenting, has not yet quite figured out how, in fact, to bring through a coherent Christian symbolic theme and argument within his films. I would be hard-pressed. I'm not sure whether it's one or the other. But at least it's something that one would need to think about.
Cesare, I'm way in the back.
Mark.
Sorry, I hope.
Yes.
That you're not as tired as I am. And I may just be, I hope I'm not just repeating a question earlier, but I just, somehow as the discussion has gone on and the evening has gone on, I've just come back to homosexuality, as one is wont to do at these late hours. But my question is, in a sense, why homosexuality? I'm totally with you on it, but I'm trying to think, there are other kinds of in common that are not thematized. And so I'd like to hear more about how, if you have more thoughts on how it's actually homosexuality that is the void together, the incommensurability of homosexuality with communism or with being in common, if one is not. Or if one is insisting on the work as you are. I agree with it. I would just like to hear more of your thoughts about it, if you have more at this late hour.
Maybe one should put it in, or maybe I should put it in a slightly different way. And say that any idea, any concept of communism that is worth any while for me would have to be one that involved something that would be a sexual liberation. But as by sexual liberation, I don't mean what we have had. I mean, in fact, a destruction of patriarchy. So I would say it is unthinkable. For me, it is unthinkable. Communism is unthinkable without the destruction of patriarchy. Now, Pasolini is wrapping himself around this problem because it's too immured within patriarchy. It is the very thing that fuels his desire at some level. But he's struggling also to come out of it, come out of certain patriarchal structures, and to combine that with a certain idea, a very big, let's say, but a certain idea of communism. So for me, it doesn't have necessarily to do with homosexuality as such. It has to do with a different understanding of the sexual that would go beyond the patriarchal. There is no communism without that, as far as I'm concerned, and I haven't seen one quite yet. I think Pasolini was trying to dream of it, but couldn't. Pasolini's, in this sense, is an absolutely unfinished project. But he did point the way to the problem, it seems to me.
Talking about unfinished project, perhaps the last question. Our title of the series is "The Revolution Happens Anyway." Is that a good title for you? Was that a good title for you? Is that something that fits to Pasolini's cinema as you are thinking about it?
And by any way, you mean specifically, it happens whether one likes it or not. It always happens. It is always happening.
Nevertheless, yeah. Better.
Ah, despite of everything. I would say yes.
That's good.
I would say yes, simply because I am really not utopian. If there is revolution, if there's anything you want to call a revolution, it's here and now. That is, there are bits and pieces of things that happen. So this is something that is always happening in spite of itself and in spite of everything else, I hope.
That's the perfect ending. Thank you very much, Cesare Casarino.
Thank you very much for the late hour.
It's so great to have you here. Your applause.
Of course.
Thank you.
Thank you.